is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon. Welcome to another edition of the Hit Back with Nahaja Black. Now, you may wonder why this heavy voice is not Nahaja Black. First, let me say good afternoon and blessings to all of you. It's a great day in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. I was able to contact my good sister, and she said to me, well, you know, fame, blah, 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 certain opportunities. Why don't you sit in for me today? And I was happy that she had that thought in mind, because I wanted really to share today an issue which impacts all of us and impacts our minds and impacts our hearts. And of course, that would be the events of yesterday. So we were going to discuss general stuff, but she said, well, Finn, you go ahead and you do what you got to do. The one, two things I wanted to do. So let me say to you, welcome to the Hit Back with Nahaja Black. Finn Thompson sitting in this afternoon for Nahaja, and we welcome you to the show. Let me begin by telling you that as we go along today, there will be pregnant pauses, like right now. Pregnant pauses are things you do when you want to recognize people in a solemn moment. As I begin the show, there's going to be a pregnant pause. Because that pregnant pause is important to reflect what happened yesterday in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, something which I think is one of the most serious events that our country has ever seen. And we're going to talk about that today, and I want you guys to chime in. Some of my views you will agree with. Some of my views you will not agree with. I take that point, and I respect that. Today, we have telephone line 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. Let me just repeat those numbers. 323-6232, 325-4316, and 325-4259. And we want you to call in at the appropriate time and share with me your agreement or your disagreement. Because as far as I'm concerned, yesterday afternoon on the corner of Chesapeake and Jerome Avenue is a watershed moment in Bahamian history. A watershed moment. I'm going to try to make that case to you today. And I enjoy the opportunity to do that. And I'd like to thank my producers, who's been getting me up to speed real fast, my two producers, and of course, my good friend on the controls. So again, welcome to Nahaja Black. Today, Fane Thompson sitting in. First, I want to begin with a pregnant pause. Give me 5 seconds of another pregnant pause, because that recognizes the death of young men. Too many young men, too many people yesterday on the streets of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas in the most violent, murderous display that we have ever seen in this country. We have now approached the level of Chicago gangland-type slayings taking place in our country. And I'm going to begin that way with a pregnant pause. And then as we go out, sometimes when I want to make a point, I'll pause. That's only pregnant for a few seconds. That's to recognize the moment at which we have arrived. Pregnant pause. I want to say to you, ladies and gentlemen, those of you who are listening today, that I hope to convince you of a mindset which many of you know I have had for many, many years. That's why I thank you, Nahaja, for this opportunity. Many of you followed me on Facebook and various other places, and you know my views on certain things which have to do with what's going on in the country. And today, our particular topic is going to be what happened in Chesapeake and Jerome Avenue yesterday is not new. It happened in Fox Hill. On June the 19th of 2019. It has happened throughout the Bahamas over the last 20 to 30 years for reasons which have to do with wanton attacks by young men upon young men in a society which does not understand how serious that is. The fact that there's a slow homicide, that there's a slow genocide, and we are depleting that resource of young men and young people who consider hopefully the fathers and mothers of our future. Too many young men are dying on the streets, and it's too much foolishness. It's time to talk about it. I want you guys out there to join me, because I'm going to suggest to you another narrative, and that's going to be that we can do something about it, and we can do something about it very easily, without having any long talk, without politicians running up and down with foolishness. We can do something about it very easily if we just focus our minds to the issue, deal with it, and proceed and move ahead. So I want today, again, also to recognize those who died in Fox Hill. Because if you understand yesterday, you must understand the context within which we experienced Fox Hill in 2019. And let me extend my condolences to the families of young men who died last night, either those who were pulling those triggers or those who may have lost their lives either innocently or otherwise in that car. That is how important this particular moment in time is in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. You know, I heard someone try to compare what happened yesterday to 1964 and Mr. Roll, who ran about New Providence killing people, and there was a total of 7 people who died, and then he killed himself at the end of it all. But that was a distraught man. He lost the love of his life, and he lost his mind, and he ran about killing Bahamians in 1964. And of course, I heard stories about it. I was a babe, but I heard stories about it. I heard stories about it, and it struck me as weird that somehow a reference was made on Facebook yesterday, which I thought was interesting, social media, that event predates yesterday, and somehow the biggest mass murder that ever took place in the Bahamas did not take place last night. They're trying to suggest it took place in 1964 when 7 people died. But let me just tell you how serious yesterday was. Mr. Roll lost his mind because he lost his love. No one can justify his behavior. Yesterday was a display of Chicago-style gangland homicide taking place in broad daylight in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, 250 meters or maybe 400 meters away from a police station. A police station. It was gangland style. It was strategic. It was surgical. It was professional. A little untidy because I'm going to suggest to you, a little untidy because in that process, 6 people died. Persons waited until they finished their job, emptied their clips, turned around, and disappeared as quickly as they came. I'm still not convinced that they were Bahamians who did that yesterday. I'm still not convinced of that. I've heard many, many stories today, all sorts of speculation about people from that particular country, one of our sister countries in the South, coming in, doing their due, and then leaving. Some people have actually suggested that they've been gone. That they've been gone. That by about 6 o'clock yesterday morning or this morning, they were gone. So we'll never find out who committed that particular homicide, as I think. But if we do find out who committed that homicide, let me say to the Royal Bahamas Police Force, we need to help our police officers and our police force to interdict, to find those men, and to bring them before the courts so that they may be held responsible for what happened yesterday. Yesterday, a body blow was struck against our democracy. Pregnant pause. Yesterday, we found out how serious it was, the fragility of the world in which we live. That's what happened yesterday. Yesterday was 100 yards from where my aunt and my cousins used to live. Yesterday was 50 meters away from the church, across the street. Had this happened later on that night, that would have been a bloodbath. But this was strategic. This was surgical. So this was professional. And I'm going to suggest to you that if we talk about this today, it had to have been financed by somebody who knew what they were doing and dispatched their soldiers to do the job. So what are we talking about today? I'm going to suggest to you that it is time now to look at the criminal justice system. It is time now to stop pussyfooting around with what we're going to do for our young men. It is time now to end. It's coming. It is time now to end. It's coming. Pregnant pause, baby. Maybe another pregnant pause. It is time now to end the drug war. That's how we can start today. We can start today that way because I'm motivated to start that way today. I sought my friend out this morning. He was nice enough to allow me to come in and share a few thoughts with him. And I'm thankful. And what Levon put onto the table was powerful stuff. The suggestion that he put out there was that this thing had to have been done by a professional. It had to have been extremely well-financed. What the police are facing with this particular matter from yesterday, I do not believe it's a simple low-level, what I would call low-level retaliation or retaliatory strike between a bunch of fellows who get mad because of something that happened on the beach. This is not about no girl. This is not about somebody's just basic respect, maybe about respect. This is about a business, a culture, in which we find ourselves having to struggle to maintain peace and quiet in Little Nassau, 21x7. And we don't even use the 21x7. Most of it is beached off. In Little Nassau, consider this, 21x7, gangland style Chicago came to the Bahamas yesterday. So yes, this was the worst homicide in Bahamian history. I disagree with you, Ms. Roberts. It was the worst homicide in Bahamian history ever committed on our shores, ever committed in our land. The worst homicide. It was bold, it was brazen, it was ballsy, it was serious, and it was an attack on our democracy. And that's the challenge that the Commissioner of Police today faces, and that's the challenge that the Minister of National Security faces, and I'm going to come back to them as we develop our thoughts today. Remember now, you have some pauses. You can have some pauses, because I want you to really let it sink in. And I'm going to invite you to call in a little later on in the show. Let me set the stage of the show, because this is the moment in time when you're going to hear the conversation that very rarely you hear in the country. Because the conversation we've heard recently, over the past few months, over the past few years, is legalized marijuana for the purposes of medical marijuana. So all you've been hearing. Now it seems that recommendations have come forth and the government is taking the view of legalizing marijuana for the purposes of medical use. I thought that the whole exercise of looking at drugs and the introduction of drugs and trying to protect and rescue our young men from themselves had to do with bringing peace to our streets. Carlos Reed always talks about it. With bringing peace to our streets. But no, we blinked, I'm going to suggest to you, because we blinked by suggesting that all we need to do now is to set up another cartel of businessmen, about 6 or 7, the way we did in the numbers business. Give them licenses that only they can control. Let them become multimillionaires, and the violence on the streets would continue. I thought that we missed a tremendous opportunity. So when I hear discussion, when I hear talk about legalizing marijuana simply for the purposes of medical use, I'm going to say we blinked. Pregnant pause. We blame because we did not understand that the war on the streets is a war. But that war is generated by the logic, by the way in which we've decided to police marijuana, drugs, cocaine, all drugs in this country from the mid-1980s. Let me begin by saying, as I start, that I need about 20 minutes to develop these thoughts, and I'm going to bring you guys in. But I want those of you in particular who disagree with me to share with me. Let's be agreeable. Let's not be disagreeable, but let's disagree. But we must be agreeable. But we must be nice. In other words, what is the drug war? Because basically, I've been putting this point in one. For those of you who want to see a bit more about some of the things that I've been talking about over the years, I started on Facebook a page called Citizens Against Prohibition. Citizens Against Prohibition. I need some youngsters to step forward to take that page over now, because I've been busting my chops on this now for a long time. Citizens Against Prohibition. I come from the criminal justice system. I know it extremely well. In fact, I know it better than most of those who sit down and seek to pontificate as to how it should be dealt with. I've studied it. I've never stopped studying it. Because to my mind, to understand why our country seems to be so destabilized by crime and violence, I said to myself, it's about time to study. Is it that policymakers are afraid to deal with it? I want to say something about my good friend, the Attorney General. And he's my good friend, and he knows that I love him dearly, and I know he has regard for me. He indicated a few weeks, maybe a few months ago, that the Bahamas will not move towards the legalization of marijuana or the legalization of drugs because he's minded to see what the federal government and the United States is doing as regards drug interdiction. We see that the states across America are legalizing marijuana for the purposes of recreational use. We see that it's happening all across America. But the federal government is still holding on. And now, unfortunately, President Joe Biden is a retrograde. He's taken the view that he's not going to legalize marijuana in his term as president, unfortunately. I think that's an unfortunate development. Because if you look at this particular thing very, very seriously, we will see how important this conversation is. Not just to what's going on in the United States, but what's going on the streets of New Providence. That which started in the 1970s in the United States is now having a devastating impact on our democracy, a devastating impact in terms of destroying our young men, a devastating impact in terms of really bastardizing the criminal justice system and the many laws which have been passed in aid of this particular agenda. First, let me set the stage. The 1980s in the Bahamas, when this particular issue came to the Bahamas, was steeped in an explosive era where drugs, the cocaine world, and the Bahamas was the so-called entry point for 70% of cocaine, which went through this particular part of the Atlantic Ocean into the United States. That's correct. The Bahamas was responsible for the explosion in the use of drugs in this particular region because of the many Bahamians and foreigners who were part of the transshipment from the southern climes of Latin America into the United States to feed that voracious appetite that Americans have to use drugs and to consume drugs. The Bahamas was part of that. The Bahamas changed as a result of that. But with that coming change, certain other things that happened. It compromised our political system. You've heard the stories about what happened in the 1980s with politicians. It compromised our judicial system. You heard the stories about police officers and their compromise. You've also heard the stories about lawyers and their compromise. You've heard the stories about all sorts of ways in which this particular drug world impacted the Bahamas. You've also heard that it caused an economic boom in the Bahamas. But with that boom came some negative side effects. And remember now, this is also that stage in our history when, in fact, the Bahamas' government was seriously embattled, having to face all sorts of allegations about the nation being for sale, the drug paradise, and all of that. That was the context within which our government submitted to what I consider to be one of the most draconian drug regimes in this particular region, which started out necessarily as a good thing, but it has turned into really one of the worst things that the Bahamas could possibly continue to enforce or to apply. First, let me say I was not invited to address the Marijuana Commission. I guess because, and I ain't talking about my family, they figured that my views were not like theirs. But had I been invited to have done the same thing I'm going to hopefully do today and to get you guys to do in terms of a conversation, we would have done. They would have heard me. And maybe that would have impacted some of them. Because clearly the position which we've now taken was an opportunity right there given to us. The position that we took to simply talk about legalizing marijuana without more for medicinal purposes is a waste of time. Pregnant pause. So what is the drug war? What is the drug war? And like I guess some of you guys are calling in right now. I'm not going to answer any particular calls right now. We're going to try to set the stage for this conversation, then I want you guys to call in. Because some of you will agree with me and some of you won't. We also have, for those of you who want to text in 422-4796, feel free to text, and then we'll respond to you when we finally go to that part of the show. 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. I thank Guardian Radio for the opportunity to be able to sit and to have this conversation with the Bahamian people. A brief history of the drug war. And we must understand why this is so important. What is a drug war? First, let me say that it is counterintuitive. You have to, in many ways, think backwards to understand what war means. The drug war to which I refer does not mean war. You go there, you try to break heads, you try to stop young men from doing their business, from doing what they do by simply threatening them with guns and jailing. That's not the scope of the drug war entirely. It's a part of it, but a small part of it. The bigger, most important thing when we talk about a drug war is the idea that somehow the state has the ability, this is very important for those of you who are listening to me, the ability that the state, the government, our leaders have the ability to impact the incidence of violent crimes coming out of the drug war and to impact that by using certain mechanisms that have to do with laws and the number of police officers we have on the streets. One of the biggest and most naive ways of thinking about that is to think about it this way. More police on the streets, more intrusions into our civil liberties, more stop and searches on the streets, more bringing police officers into contact with young men on the streets for search and just search and seizure will supposedly bring calm to our streets. But we have seen manifestly that cannot work. Consider this. We had an opportunity to address these issues. The Marijuana Commission, and Quinn, I love you, my brother, but I got to say this. We had an opportunity to deal with that, but the point that we came to was a lukewarm suggestion to simply regularize the sale of marijuana for people who are sick, and there's nothing wrong with that. By the way, I don't smoke marijuana, I don't indulge, and I don't encourage people to. All right? But having said that, a brief history of the drug war. The reason why I must give a brief history is because it's important to understand that the drug war goes beyond arrest and simple incarceration. Its roots are embedded in almost every aspect of our life. Remember now, the Bahamas in the 1980s clearly became a narco culture, a narco economy. There were three major tenets of our economy, even though we only speak to two. What the three was banking and financial services, tourism, but we never wanted to speak about the narco economy. If there's one of those three elements of our economy, the one that really caused a tremendous and massive boom in the change of life for many Bahamians up and down the archipelago of this nation was the narco economy. The narco economy was that underground economy where the goods and services of the drug world were plied liberally. There's no question about that. And it changed forevermore the nature of the Bahamas. Where, for example, the Bahamas was a sleepy fishing village in the 1970s. By the 1980s to the early 1990s, it became a narco economy. And when that change comes, all the cultural negative attributes which come with that came along with them. So, for example, the need to run a business which was illicit, that is to say, transshipping the drug world and those drugs which was kept here and sold, impacted and changed the way our people lived, impacted and changed the values that our people took seriously, notwithstanding the fact that many of us like to talk about the Bahamas being this Christian nation. Some of those persons who benefited most were pastors and pastors' families in the furthest inclines of some of these islands where nobody knew that the drugs was being kept under the pulpit. Don't ask me how I know about that, because I know about that. I know about that. So I'm suggesting to you that the Bahamas changed drastically in the 1980s. But it changed at a time. It changed at a time when there were some other things going on in the world. When, for example, in the 1970s, Richard Nixon In the 1960s, as drugs became symbols of youthful rebellion, I quote, social upheaval and political dissent, the U.S. government halted scientific research to evaluate the medical safety and efficacy. In 1971, President Nixon declared a war on drugs. Lotus, listen to me, ladies and gentlemen, a war on drugs. This ain't come from us. Just the very concept ain't come from us. It came from Richard Nixon. In June 1971, Nixon declared a war on drugs. He dramatically increased the size and presence of federal drug control agencies and pushed through measures such as mandatory sentencing and no-knock warrants. Mandatory sentencing, minimum mandatory sentencing, something we can talk about today. A top Nixon aide, ladies and gentlemen, please listen to me. Please listen to me. A top Nixon aide, John Ehrlichman, later admitted, please listen to me, ladies and gentlemen, I got to go into my pregnant pause. A top Nixon aide said, you want to know what this was really all about? The Nixon campaign in 1968 and the Nixon White House after that had two enemies. The anti-war left, people like Martin Luther King and all of those people, and black people. I can say it again. The Nixon campaign in 1968 and the Nixon White House after that had two enemies, the anti-war and black people. You understand what I'm saying? We knew we couldn't make it illegal to be either against the war or black. But by getting the public to associate hippies with marijuana and black people with heroin, and then criminalizing both heavily, we would disrupt those communities. We would arrest their leaders, raid their homes, break up their meetings, and vilify them night after night. Night after night on the evening news. Did we know we were lying about the drugs? Of course we did. Nixon temporarily placed marijuana in Schedule 1, the most restrictive category of drugs, pending review by a commission he appointed, led by Republican Pennsylvania Governor Raymond Schaefer. I give you that history to put this into context. Nixon's number one aide tells a story about where the drug war came. Now, you may ask, what does that have to do with the Commonwealth of the Bahamas? It has everything to do with us. Because remember now our relationship between our American brothers. Remember now Operation BAT, Op Bat. I want those of you who are not studying today, take your notes, take your pens out. Please review this material. It ain't just me who has this view. This is your history. Between 1973, 1977, maybe, and into the late 1980s, a series of pieces of legislation and international norms were agreed between the United States government and the Bahamas government. In many ways, we were obliged. We were obliged to confer with our brothers from the North, and in many cases, it's important. And we embraced thereby a strict policing policy, which was almost identical to the fake war on drugs, which was launched by Nixon in the United States. We then began to incorporate these very ideas, which became so popular in the United States, into the Bahamian experience, thereby establishing our own war on drugs. I remember as a young prosecutor, I remember the fervor with which we all did our work. And let me tell you, we did our work with fervor. We thought that we were doing the right thing by applying rules, for example, like the mandatory sentencing. That is to say, if you get busted once, twice, or whatever period of time, if you get arrested with more than 2 pounds of a dope on you or in multiple packages, the charge had to be possession with intent to supply, not simple possession. I remember the rules. I remember how the world changed, so much so that the so-called accused drug possessor, drug dealer, became almost like a monster in the Bahamian context. And with the difficulty that the PLP faced in the late 1980s, it became even more apparent that laws were passed under the pressure of the American brother. I'll give you an example of them right now. The Dangerous Drugs Act gained two times its teeth. Mandatory minimums became the norm. That is to say, a magistrate could not impose a sentence less than a particular time because that was beyond his power. That was later declared unconstitutional in 2001, 2011, and I think some of you who've been following this particular issue closely know what I'm talking about. But between the 1980s and moving then into our time, the 21st century, we employed a drug regime of laws which literally imposed upon us a drug war which was devastating. And how do I know that? Chaswell Hanna is one of the most gifted men in the Bahamas. Now, he works for the Royal Bahamas Police Force. I don't know what he is. He may be superintendent. They say he's supposed to be future commissioner of police. But Chaswell Hanna did a book, which I interviewed him about many years ago on Parliament Street. And Chaswell Hanna spoke to the particular incidences of murder or the particular incidents of crime and where they came from and what were their roots and what were their social causes. It was both a review of where crime was coming from, an assessment of the social impact of those crimes and which communities seemingly were being faced by them. But interestingly about his book, Reducing Murders in the Bahamas, let me quote him properly. You give a man work for his hard work, You give a man kudos for his hard work. Interesting what he said was that the incidence of, well, I want you to read his book. I won't help you to form an opinion. That the incidence of these particular crimes seem to be dominant in certain parts of the islands. And he indicated the dates and time and the numbers of homicides started to increase. You see, because as we imposed the so-called drug war in the Bahamas, we began to impose some very draconian rules to police a business, a narco economy, which is beyond policeableness. I can tell you what that means. Because of the very nature of the drug trade, because of the very nature of its intensely personal relationship that it brings between people, because of the fact that it was illicit, illegal, certain norms had developed around it for it to go on. On the criminal side, the drug man had to be ever careful to watch his back. He had to employ a slew of soldiers to cover his back. He had to employ, he had to corrupt police officers. He had to corrupt lawyers. He had to corrupt magistrates, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, to get his work done. Because part and parcel of his business, his extremely profitable business, was the need to be successful. In identifying the rise of the so-called new level of violence which has rocked this country, Mr. Hanna identified when it began. And he identified it by virtue of looking at the slope, that's to say from zero, and the steady incline of homicides which have been taking place in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas for the last 30 to 40 years. This didn't start yesterday. Chesapeake and Jerome Avenue did not start yesterday. Chesapeake and Jerome Avenue started many, many years ago. And first, let me say this. Let me be very clear as I go on before I go back to Mr. Hanna. By no means am I suggesting that we demonize anyone in those cars or anyone who did the alleged shooting on the day in question. Every man and woman is entitled to the presumption of innocence to be wrapped around him until such time as a competent court of jurisdiction finds him guilty. But there is no question that it is fair comment to say that the particular style of killing yesterday invites research. Because clearly, yesterday, that which happened yesterday is no different from what happened to the Foxhill Congos on June the 19th, 2019. Wanton violence in Foxhill, as opposed to strategic, planned, and surgical violence yesterday on Jerome Avenue, pregnant poor. Now, the reason why we start the show this way, and we can take a break, I understand, at 30 minutes past the hour. The reason why this is important information is because as we go about trying to understand what happened yesterday, we have to be realistic. And Mr. Chaswell Hanna, as I mentioned him just a few minutes ago, allows us, all we have to do is to do the research, to understand where this comes from. First and foremost, I said, we inherited a drug war from our American brothers by virtue of the relationship between us and the compromise of governments in the 1980s. They had no choice. Just for survival, when the Americans came to them, they had to comply to a large extent with certain requests. The very regime of Operation OBAT and some of these laws are indications of the need to which our government capitulated under tremendous pressure to embrace the so-called lunatic drug war. But that drug war brought with it severe penalties. It brought with it tremendous pressure on the Royal Bahamas Police Force to be seen to be interdicting a particular form of endeavor, that is to say, the purchase and sale of drugs, the transshipment of drugs into and out of the Bahamas, they were brought under tremendous pressure to be seen to be getting the job done in that regard. And let me say this, to the extent that there were major busts, to the extent that there were major arrests, to the extent that the police were appeared to be doing something in this regard, it can be said that from the policing point of view, there was some success. But, and this is important, no success. None success, no success from the 1980s until today's date. And yesterday afternoon can be said for the law and order strategy of trying to quell our streets and to bring peace back to our streets by taking on this particular scourge of drug-related violence. And that's what I'm going to speculate, ladies and gentlemen, as we go on, that yesterday was about drug-related violence. And I'm going to hopefully take you through some material which points that out. If you disagree with it, please do. Don't call and talk fool, though. Talk sense. So I have to go quiet and let you speak. And let us agree that this conversation you have never heard before. Never. I can say it. You know who gets very close to it and Guardian, my good friend, and to some extent Levon? Juan McCartney. But very rarely do we have the conversation which talks to looking at what has caused this country to become destabilized, our democracy to be destabilized essentially by the very regime we employ to maintain the rule of law in the country, which is the drug war. So the drug war brought with it a destabilizing impact. It destroyed families, young men, because of the multiple offenses which of course were thrown at them. It destroyed friendships. It destabilized our police force at certain levels. I'm sure it caused tremendous compromise with some of our magistrates. And I'm not going to say Supreme Court judges. I've not heard about anyone. But it caused a kind of destabilization the persons could not have imagined. And it also leveled a body blow at our democracy with the passage of some of the most unconstitutional legislation which we have seen since the 1980s in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. And I'm going to deal with those. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let me say this. That wasn't a pregnant pause. That was catching my breath. All right? I want to begin or continue by saying this. That to date, the graphs will all show and reveal a steady rise of the homicide rates, this is where I get specific, in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, and no slowing down of those rates from the late 1980s until yesterday. Now, there have been ups and downs. You see, even the drug economy, the narco economy, in which society in which we live, has cyclical ups and downs. Even that economy has cyclical ups and downs. If you don't believe my analysis, please go out there and review it. My good friends who I'm sure are listening know I don't talk fool. Cyclical events. That is to say, there are some years when we have highs. We got as high as 145 murders, I think, in 2015 or 2014. I don't remember the year. 145, I think it was. We've been as low, I think, as maybe last year, 70 or 80. I don't know what the numbers are. But for a country where we have a modest country of about 300,000 people or 400,000 people, whatever, we have one of the highest homicide rates per capita in the world. In fact, we are murder city in the world. Not too far after Honduras, Guatemala, Jamaica, and other countries. We have a higher homicide per capita rate than the United States. We have a higher homicide per capita rate than Canada. We have a higher homicide per capita rate than Cuba with 12 million people. The Bahamas has become so steeped in the culture of the drug of the drug trade and the drug war and its attendant problems that we have a homicide rate which rivals right now this little terraformer of 21/7, Chicago. Because if you think in terms of the Bahamas as being New Providence, Chicago, we are rivaling. Because what happened yesterday is truly a madness. Having said that, I need to cooperate. I need to control the streets. Or these issues, I should say, have arisen for a number of reasons. One, the wholesale employment or taking over of the American drug war style. The police on the streets, the knocking of heads, the stopping of people in the streets. The heavy-handedness at times, and the Royal Bahamas Police Force is a good police force. You know what I say? Some of the best in the business. They have a reputation for being good. But there's some negative sides to the embrace of the so-called drug war logic. The very thing you see American police officers doing, walking around in military fatigues and pulling up in armored cars, that has become the watchword now in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. We have so mimicked the American idea about the drug war, or the need to interdict drugs, or the need to interdict crime and punishment in this particular narco economy, that we've embraced every negative and bad practice of our American brothers. All again, a la Richard Nixon. And we now know, based upon his own man, what the drug war in the United States in 1971 was all about. The escalating homicide rate begins in the early 80s, and since then a consistent, dogged rise in one direction has occurred. What of the legislation which countless attorneys general, ministers of national security, and commissioners of police? What about these escalating homicide rates? Well, one thing is interesting. As I get to this particular point, I want to just very, very quickly make it clear that as regards the differences between the PLP and the FNM, there are no differences. They have all hung close and tight to the idea that we can police ourselves through this crisis by using the tools, the recommendation, the model that the Americans employ in seeking to so-called control the streets. And the only streets we have to control and monitor really is Freeport, Grand Bahama, and Little Nassau. Let's be real now. A number of techniques have been used to employ the so-called war on drugs, to execute it. And I want to deal with them very, very quickly. I want to deal with them to the extent that it may show you guys out there what's going on. What is the Dangerous Drugs Act? Its efficacy is known for all. Useless. It does not achieve the specific objective of quelling the streets. Because remember now, laws are designed to maintain the rule of law. But we've had an escalating rate of homicide for the last 30 years. So clearly, the Dangerous Drugs Act, and its many amendments in the 1980s and the 1990s, has not achieved that objective. Let me tell you how bad it got. For the various things that PLPs, continue PLPs and FNM attorneys general and other law enforcement officers have done. They have increased, for example, the power of the, they have diminished the power, at one point they diminished the power of the magistrates to ensure more convictions in the courts. This is the history of our war on drugs, ladies and gentlemen. This is our history. I got to write the book one day. But this is the history. We've actually, at one point, it was mandatory minimums required a certain punishment without more. Two strikes, I think, or two knocks, and you were gone under the Dangerous Drugs Act. Or, for example, I think it's Section 21 or Section 22. It actually suggested and stated that clearly, if you were convicted and being found in possession of more than one packet, either marijuana, cocaine, whatever it may be, possession with intent to supply a came, and there would be no chance of you being able to negotiate a plea deal. And equally, once you had that conviction, you were done for life. In fact, under the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act, the war on drugs still saddles our young men with the burden of not being able to work, not being able to get their lives in order, not being able to travel because of the so-called strictures of possession with intent to supply, even in 2021. And what about the damage that was done to the Bail Act? When we come back, we can continue this opening. This is a long opening and we can finish soon. But I challenge you guys, the pregnant pause is coming, to chime in. We'll be right back.
In life, there are always challenges. Today, we find ourselves having to be more self-sufficient, socially aware, and technically savvy. At J.S. Johnson, we are committed to our customers by providing cost-effective insurance solutions. No matter what your insurance needs, we will always be here for you. Call 397-2100 or visit jsjohnson.com. J.S. Johnson Insurance Agents and Brokers, giving you peace of mind.
When I had got prostate cancer, my family didn't know if I was going to live. At Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Within days, I got an appointment. They presented me with treatment options, and they set up a robotic prostatectomy. When my scans came back, there are no signs of cancer. They don't see you as a number, they see you as a part of family. I'm going on with my life. It's a real gift.
Call us at Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
Come in to Nassau Motor Company and find new roads with a Chevrolet, because we've got a wide range of models for you, from the economical Spark to the sporty Trax and Equinox, or the ever-popular Traverse, or the Tahoe and Suburban. Need a truck? Then the Colorado or Silverado pickups will fit the bill. Find new roads with Chevrolet at Nassau Motor Company on Shirley Street. Call 302-0130, where standards are higher.
Imagine. That's where every advancement begins, with an idea that things can be different, better. Now, imagine a world where your entertainment experience was all about you, your style, your show, at your budget. At Rev, that's what we've imagined. To join the conversation and learn more about the future of Rev TV, visit us at rev.bs/imagine.
Hello, sir. Your credit card bill is due. Hello, sir. It's time for your monthly loan payment. Tired of creditors pounding at your door? Sign up for a debt consolidation loan from Fidelity Bank and consolidate your debt into one low monthly payment. What's more, you will also earn interest on a built-in savings account. The pandemic has curbed many freedoms, but at Fidelity, our focus is to help regain your financial freedom. Visit a branch or speak to a Fidelity Bank at 356-7764. COVID safety measures in place at all branches. Fidelity, we're good for you.
For the past 33 years, Great Commission Ministries has been defending the poor and hurting, feeding the hungry, and sheltering the homeless. We invite you to support our Live to Give program and make a difference in these challenging times. Become a donor by giving a one-time annual gift or a monthly donation of $50 or $100. Call Great Commission Ministries at 325-5801 for more details. Or visit our headquarters at 237 Wolf Road. Join Live to Give today. This public service announcement is proudly sponsored by this radio station.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Welcome back. The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. Faye Thompson's in studio today, holding on for my good sister. She's giving me an opportunity to... I ain't gonna make no altar call at the end of the show, but definitely I'm gonna invite the Bahamian people to put the pressure on the legislators to look at this again, because yesterday is a sad day, and if you value human life, you know that we're making some big mistakes, and we have to correct those mistakes. I'm gonna continue with my prolonged introduction, and I'm gonna open up the line soon. I want you to hold on, but if you really want to make a point, make some notes and let's talk about it. Now, one particular person is saying that I'm speaking too quickly. Forgive me. It ain't often I get in this particular studio. When I get in this studio, there's some things you got to do. But I appreciate that, and I'm going to try to better and more clearly define what I'm saying for you so that you can hear. I also have something across my mouth, and I'm trying to make sure that I comply with the competent authority, but there you go. So I mentioned where we are and what all and what multiple governments have been doing to this point. Because, you see, you guys want to know why is all of this so important. Because all of these so-called tools that have been employed by the state, all of these so-called ideas which have been employed to so-called, as it were, bring peace to the streets by using the law enforcement, the big arm of the state, that is to say the policing mechanism of the state, I'm suggesting to you that they have all been used for naught, and they have not worked. And like states across America have found out they did not work, they've begun to legalize in areas where, for example, legalization could be done. And they've done so with tremendously positive results. I've not even mentioned Portugal, or for that matter, Uruguay. I've not even mentioned, for example, what happened in the 1930s in the United States as regards prohibition. I'm going to get there in a couple of minutes. But I have to set the stage so that you understand where I'm coming from, so that we may better understand the point that I'm trying to make. Because when we finish the show today, I know if you can hear me again like this for a while, I want you guys to go there and say to the Minister for National Security, well, why do you think put more police on the streets can do anything to stop that? You couldn't stop that. You know, if you dreamt that, you couldn't stop it. Mr. Roll is a decent man, the commissioner. Very good man. Very nice man. But the fact of the matter is, we are propping them up to fail by suggesting that somehow it's all going to be resolved because they have a press conference, including the MP, and all will be well. That is so totally disingenuous. Notice I didn't say dishonest. Disingenuous. That's not the measure that we should employ in dealing with this question. And again, I'm going to say it, and I love you, Quinn. The commission blinked. As I was saying, successive governments have employed the measures of changing our laws, tinkering with our laws, enhancing the power of the state, increasing the length of sentences, denying magistrates the right to as it were, admit persons to bail, taking the right or the power to admit to bail from the magistrate to the Supreme Court. All sorts of measures have been employed by the state, politicians under the gun, to so-called fight this war. They put more police on the streets. They buy every time a new government comes in a whole bunch of new cars, all in aid of fighting the so-called fighting crime. Let me say that fighting crime is absolutely essential. I'm suggesting to you, though, that most of the crime, as Superintendent Hanna seems to suggest, comes from that culture of drugs, which has rocked this country now for 30, 40 years. What are the Dangerous Drugs Act? I've spoken about that. What about the Bail Act, Section 4? I think I've spoken about that for the lawyers listening. What about the explosive increase in the police force? Was there a need for that? And I'm suggesting to you that outside the so-called disingenuous policy position that we need more police to police the streets, there was no reason for it. It was a contrived point of view designed to justify politicians coming in and spending millions and millions of dollars on this, that, and the next. Now we get drones flying over our homes and we don't even know. All of that in aid of interdicting crime. Now listen, as I said, crime per se has to be interdicted. And the Royal Bahamas Police Force has a reputation for being effective in certain areas, except when it comes to the interdiction of drug-related crime. Now they don't mind that there was this big bust the other day, I understand, some 300 pounds of dope somewhere. That happens every once in a while, but it's nothing compared to measuring whether or not the drug war itself has had the efficacy that it needs to have in bringing peace to our streets. So, for example, there's been no diminution, no reduction in the frequency of offenses, over the years. In fact, they've gone up. The legislation has created, which has been created to prosecute drug-related crimes, a piece of legislation like this, the forfeiture and seizure of assets. Some lawyers say it's unconstitutional. The question is, has that been an erosion on our civil liberties? The passage of that piece of legislation, I think it was in the 1980s. The Listening Devices Act has now become, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, Commissioner, the exclusive preserve now of technocrats behind the scenes to determine whether or not a listening device should be, well, I think the Commissioner of Police, whether or not listening devices should be discreetly employed against citizens in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. There's no obligation to go to a court now to get certain mechanisms for investigation of crime obtained. If a decision is to be made, it may be made by functionaries of the state, not judges, not the legislature. And of course, we cannot forget the unconstitutional mandatory minimum sentence, which had the impact of exploding the size and number of young men and women in our prisons for silly, stupid offenses. You see, I'm going to say to you, ladies and gentlemen, at the end of the day, that what we must understand and appreciate is that the drug war has done nothing more than to destabilize our country, throw hundreds of thousands of young men in behind bars for nothing, destroyed their lives over foolishness, because most of them are there for simple possession or possession matters. Ask the commodore of the prison, or the commandant of the prison. Ask those who know this particular business. We've employed a system, a regime of interdiction, which is identical to the one that Richard Nixon contrived, essentially to control the blacks, what we know that's about, inner city crime or inner city issues. And we know what devastating that is, that impact that has had on families in the inner city. Now, first, let me say that if you guys a little later on agree with some of the suggestions that we'll be discussing about what should be done, clearly it's going to be about do not mix up, for example, the question of drug-related crimes, the narco economy, and those other matters which require absolute and immediate attention by the Royal Bahamas Police Force. Do not confuse me. Do not suggest that what I'm saying here today, that somehow is that the police must back off from the interdiction of crime and the rule of law. Absolutely not. I prosecuted these businesses. I put plenty of people in a certain place. I did that myself. I'm not proud of some of it, because as far as I'm concerned now, in hindsight, some of those laws which I had to apply were draconian, unnecessary, and unconstitutional. But I have to admit that. That's my mea culpa today. Pregnant pause. That is my mea culpa today. That is my act of contrition and begging for forgiveness. Because when I look back and I recognize what we did, and when I look at the various countries around the world that seem to be admitting that this was one of the biggest mistakes, this so-called drug war, which was employed and began by Richard Nixon with his disingenuous objectives. We employed across the Caribbean, especially in the southern flank of the United States, the same regime of laws with devastating, destructive social effect. Not for the interdiction of crime per se, but for the interdiction specifically of drug-related crime in a space which was serving the voracious appetite for drugs of the American people, which appetite is now being serviced in many states legally, but in the Bahamas, if the stuff that goes into Florida legal to be consumed, recreationally, if you find it in the Bahamas, you get busted and your life is destroyed. But it's going through the Bahamas now, to Florida. And once it hit Florida, it's legal, because then the federal government would not intervene. Because there may be a recreational, there's a legal possession regime there. These are some of the things that we have to talk about when we talk about the drug war. The drug war is just, not, as I said earlier when I began, it's not just simply about a police officer in a car, or more and more cars. It's about the ideas, it's about the laws, it's about the norms that we employ to police our streets. Those particular norms, and this is counterintuitive, are destabilizing our country, divesting our young men of futures. Those laws are divesting our young men and women of their futures for nothing. Now, that's the drug-related area. Please don't mix it up, because I know you all like to quote. That's what makes it up. So that the Bahamas Police Force has been found to be wanting in that regard, that's not their fault. Because when you think about drugs and the specifically highly profitable nature of that business, and when you think about the fact that it has been established to be unpoliceable, the science is in. The science is in. It is unpoliceable. Then the culture which comes from that, the warfare, the internecine warfare between gangs must be expected. This is the point. I'm bringing it home now for you, ladies and gentlemen. I'm bringing it home now for you. I'm tying it all up. Because if I'm a drug man on the streets and I got to maintain order in my team and I got to make sure I get my stuff on the streets, the fella down the road can't be undercutting me in price. The fella can't be ripping me off of my stuff. The fella can't be disrespecting me with my soldiers. Because the rule is that you're going, that you're dead. That's the rule. I can't take my civil action to the courts to get compensation. I got to settle with you on the streets. I'm not suggesting that what happened yesterday is what this is all about. But I'm suggesting that the narco economy, the narco culture is responsible for that level of violence that we saw yesterday. I'm bringing this home, ladies and gentlemen. We got to take the break for the news. Sit tight. We'll be right back.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Good afternoon, Bahamas. You're listening to the Guardian News Network. I'm Taylor Ferguson. Here's what's making news. Thank you for tuning in. The families of 30-year-old Renardo Bastian and 30-year-old Kendall Lord Jr. still reeling from Thursday's horrific shooting, which left six men dead and two others, including a toddler, in hospital. Bastian's father said he's lost three of his sons to gun violence.
Right now, I'm just trying to hold my head above water and take it as it is.
You just have to move on. You can't turn back the hands of time, so just take it one day at a time.
The mother of one of the men killed Thursday is tonight living in fear for her life and her other children. She fears retaliation.
Like, what have my son ever done, y'all? What? He spent most of his life in Fox in prison. Most of his entire 31 years from 17 incarcerated by the police for murder. All was murder. He won every case.
A toddler and a female are still in critical condition in hospital after they were caught in the crossfire of that massacre yesterday. And officers are on high alert to prevent retaliation killings.
And whether it's gang-related or not, what I'm saying is we're not going to allow any retaliation in this city tonight or tomorrow or moving forward. And I would ask those persons and say to them to surrender.
The Bahamas is now grappling with a third wave of COVID-19. That's according to Director of the National HIV, AIDS, and Infectious Disease Program, Dr. Nakia Forbes.
So we are in a third wave of COVID now, but we saw that cases were gradually going up over a certain period of time. And so when that happens, when you have a sustained increase in the number of cases over time, that's called a wave.
Since Saturday, more than 300 COVID-19 cases were reported by the Ministry of Health. The most cases for the week reported Wednesday. 58 people tested positive for COVID-19. Both Prime Minister Dr. Hubert Minnis and Health Minister Renward Wells have said there are no plans at the moment to tighten restrictions. Forbes says it will take controlled efforts to get the Bahamas out of this pandemic. And that's what's making news. I'm Taylor Ferguson. AP News is coming up next.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
For the past 33 years, Great Commission Ministries has been defending the poor and hurting, feeding the hungry, and sheltering the homeless. We invite you to support our Live to Give program and make a difference in these challenging times. Become a donor by giving a one-time annual gift or a monthly donation of $50 or $100. Call Great Commission Ministries at 325-5801 for more details. Or visit our headquarters at 237 Wolf Road. Join Live to Give today. This public service announcement is proudly sponsored by this radio station.
Coronavirus update. I'm Ed Donahue with an AP News Minute. Stocks finished higher, the Dow up 164 points. The Biden administration says it is creating a national network to track coronavirus variants that could set off another wave. Here's the AP Sagar Magani.
Virus Response Coordinator Andy Slavitt says even as the administration ramps up vaccination efforts,
more dangerous variants are growing.
He says a $1.7 billion network using funds from the president's virus relief package is aimed at getting ahead of the variants.
This funding will enable CDC and states to do more genomic sequencing.
The announcement comes as CDC Chief Rochelle Walensky says the nation's seeing more virus cases.
Nearly 70,000 new cases per day.
Up from 53,000 4 weeks ago. She says hospitalizations and deaths are also up, partly because of variants and partly because of relaxed restrictions on gatherings. Sagar Magani, Washington.
I'm Ed Donahue.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. I'm here this afternoon sitting in for my good sister, Nahaja, and it's been a joy. We're gonna open up the telephone lines in about 5-10 minutes. I want you guys to you've been long suffering. I just want to tidy up something and some housekeeping stuff in terms of what I'm doing here. 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. They are our numbers to call if you want to call in, share a comment, disagree, agree, and of course the text line is 422-4796, 422-4796. And we hope you are enjoying this show. It's a show with a difference. I didn't necessarily, I asked the producer to allow me to set the stage. It took a bit longer than I thought I would, but I felt I had to. And yes, I take your point 525, I think. I'm not going to call your number. I'm not going to complete your number. Yeah, I do speak quickly. I do not mumble. And my dialect, wow, you're the first person to say that I have a thick dialect. I get you. Okay, I have a thick dialect. These guys seem to have been arrested for guns and separated, blah, blah, blah. I'm trying to follow, but you are speaking much too fast. I get that. They tell me I have the Paul Adley problem. If anybody remembers that man, he spoke very, very quickly, but I thought I understood every word he said, but I take your point. I will try my best to discipline my voice and to control my breathing and my thought processes. But having said that, I've enjoyed the opportunity, and this is the Hit Back with Nahaja Black. I hope this show inures to your benefit. Now, before I go into finishing off my lengthy introduction, first I want to explain again why I felt moved to do this. Yesterday for me was the turning point. I felt that as a citizen of this country, I have an opportunity, take it, to make a contribution to this debate. It cannot be said that there is nowhere in the public domain a commentary which talks about doing things differently. I cannot sit back and just allow, for example, the day to pass and say, well, nothing happened. I found what was curious about this particular incident is that today, the same rancor, the same fervor, the passion with which we decried the violence in Fox Hill wasn't here today on the front page of the newspaper. The Guardian dealt with it, the Tribune dealt with it, but I didn't sense the same rancor, the same concern that was generated after the Fox Hill massacre in 2019. I don't know why that is. Have we become so inured to this type of violence that it's no big deal? I think that may be one of the things which seemingly is happening. But ladies and gentlemen, I'm telling you, it's very serious. And policymakers have an opportunity to do something about it today, now. And one way is going into Parliament and expanding the terms of reference given to you, Mr. Prime Minister, from the Marijuana Commission, to seriously look at other ways of dismantling a criminal justice system, dismantling a drug interdiction system, which is really undermining our country, undermining our democracy, and not doing the things it ought to be doing to, as it were, bring peace back to our streets. Carlos Reed's favorite words. Now, let me say this to you too. Let me also begin. I mentioned the various pieces of legislation which we were having difficulties with. Let me place at the feet of us the fault or the failure of the particular efforts which we've been employing in the so-called fake war on drugs. There's no war that can be employed against drugs in this country. It will never work. It will never work because it's a misnomer. A war on drugs is a war on our young people. A war on drugs is a war on young men, some of whom are innocent. A war on drugs is driving an illicit business underground to the point where there's only one way of settling a score. That's by murder. and mayhem. A war on drugs is passing legislation which interferes with our constitutional norms, our hard-won in 1973 constitutional norms which protect our homes, et cetera, et cetera. A war on drugs does not deal with the drug culture and the narco economy, which has risen up over the last 30 years in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, and nothing seemingly is being done to turn it around. That is what we are dealing with. That is a social crisis, not necessarily just a war, something which can be settled by a war on drugs. And I notice they don't use the term anymore because they've been listening to me sometimes. So they drop using the language. But they will come to you and talk about, we're going to put officers on the streets and we're going to make sure that no one is going to be unsafe in their communities tonight. I'm sorry, Commissioner. If someone wanted to do something wicked last night, you couldn't stop them. You could not stop them. That's not the way it works. You are there for interdiction. You are there for prevention. If, for example, you may be standing up in a house which is about to be robbed. But when it comes to this particular industry, this particular entrepreneurship in the underground criminal economy, there's very little that the police can do. And to put that pressure on the Royal Bahamas Police Force is so unfair. What do the social scientists, ladies and gentlemen, say? Does policing work, therefore, then, in this context? Does policing, and in this instance, and the answer must be, no, it is not working. It is not working because the idea of prohibition for the introduction, for the interdiction, and the reduction, or the end of homicidal violence, does not work. We've seen 30 years of failure. And this is not a negative epithet that I'm throwing at the PLP or the FNM. This is something which all ministers of national security have, by implication, accepted, that the drug culture, the drug economy, is impacting us and causing these deleterious effects on our country, changing our children, our young men, into monsters who could just coldly walk up to a car with a child and a woman in the car and spray that car with bullets. This is a form of cognitive dissonance. We've become so inured to the logic of the drug war that we don't question it. We just live with it. That is the nature of the world in which we live. I'm going to give you an example as to perhaps some of the things we can do. And this is very important. In the 1930s, you see, we must study this particular area, and I want you guys to go to Facebook, Citizens Against Prohibition on Facebook. You'll find it there if you want to, whatever, comment. And I want you to call into these numbers, 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259, and share your commentary. What do we need to do is we need to find a way to look around the world to see what other countries have done. Ladies and gentlemen, this is not, we're not inventing the wheel. We're not inventing a new wheel. Countries around the world have experimented with ways of ending the so-called deleterious impact of having to police streets and take on a society where it is replete, full, diseased with the narco economy and the narco culture. Portugal did it in 2001. Uruguay did it, I think, in 2005, or maybe 2010. Portugal did it. I mentioned Portugal, the United States in the 1930s, and of course Uruguay. All of these countries, when they experimented with trying to find creative ways to deal with the twin problems of the social health crisis, which comes from drug use, and also the violence which comes with it, they legalized it. And what happened? Peace overnight on the streets. Now, if any of you believe I would come onto this show and tell you that big lie, please don't check it out. Portugal, 2001, has been heralded around the world for a system that is working beautifully. They don't have these rampant attacks by murderous young men in cars killing people because of the logic of sick competition in an illicit business. They don't have that problem. They do not have that problem. In the United States in the 1930s, they determined by constitutional convention to declare alcohol to be illegal. There were certain states known as dry states. There were certain states known as wet states. All of them, a constitutional amendment was passed to stop the dry and the wet states from actually allowing the purchase and sale lawfully of alcohol. And we know that alcohol is one of the most dangerous drugs in the world. And in fact, it is the most dangerous drug. After 13 years of experimentation, with that prohibition, they had to stop it. You know why? Because the minute they decided to employ that new regime of prohibition across the board, violence broke out across the streets. You see, this so-called violence, which is only identified with young black men in America, parts of Chicago, Fox News loves to do that to us, has been going on in America for eons. Wherever there's a prohibition, which applies in circumstances where a prohibition cannot really work, you know what normally happens? The market, as it becomes illicit, goes underground and turns violent. and the interdiction of that particular market by the police using certain mechanisms does not help the problem. In fact, it worsens it. Because in a competitive illegal space, people will do all sorts of things to get their business, to get their business plied, to get their stuff on the streets. Prohibition didn't work in Portugal. They ended it. Peace on the streets. Prohibition didn't work. Prohibition didn't work to declare alcohol illegal in the United States. They legalized it. Peace on the streets. Overnight. We have the examples. If we simply look around the world and in the region to see how it works. In parts of Colorado and in the northwest United States, there have been reductions in crime to the extent that recreational mechanisms have been used to bring that into the mainstream. Because a lot of you, some of my friends, some Bible-pounding friends of mine, are going to suggest to me, and are going to say today, but we can't do that. Because the gateway drugs will result in an explosion of use in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. But again, the science is in. Because in every country where this particular mechanism has been employed to bring peace to the streets by taking policing out of the business of drug use, it has worked. You hear what I say? In every country in the world where that has been done, without pretense, it has worked. Portugal, it has worked. Even in the United States in the 1930s, when they decided to bring alcohol from the darkness back into the light and to regulate it and so forth, it worked. The violence stopped. In Chicago today, the very place where Babyface Nelson went around gunning people down because he couldn't sell his liquor and all the other gangsters that we hear about on TV. That violence is still going on again in the inner city of the United States. Why? Because, again, it is illegal to apply a trade which poor people have decided to turn to make a living. The drug world. Whether we like it or not, some of us will always want our mind-altering substances in our bodies. That's unfortunate. I'm going to open up the lines now in a second. If we will always want mind, some of us will always want mind-altering substances in our minds. It does not make sense to continue to demonize these people. We need to find a way to treat them. Because they are no different with people who are hooked on, for example, opioids. And do not see them as weird because there's some very functional people who actually use drugs. And I'm not, and by the way, oh, please, please don't misunderstand what I just said. Because I know some of you are going to freak out. Some people must appreciate that there's a certain inevitability of those amongst us who need or who will find the need to alter their state. To deal with maybe the difficulties of life. I'm not justifying it, I'm stating the fact. We have to find a way to police that better than to put the Royal Bahamas Police Force in the crossfire to end the crossfire. Now, we got a caller coming in. And shall we go to the line now? Yeah? Let's go to this caller because I'm gonna end in a couple. I can see that we're getting to a point where. Listen, guys, call in, please, please. If you've been waiting all day to disagree with me, please do. 323-6232-325-4316. 325-4269. Hi, caller. You there?
Hello.
Hi. Welcome to the show.
Yes, sir. The Sam Thompson.
My brother, how are you?
I've waited for some time. I really wanted to get in on this topic. Now, I totally oppose the legalization of marijuana. For medical reasons, sure, but based on what we went through, and you did a splendid job in the last hour and 20 minutes outlining what we went through in the last 80-plus years.
Thank you, sir.
With narcotics and what the fallout has been over those years, so... On that, I have a serious problem with that because what I've seen and witnessed just recently through the corner where I live, and this is just one or two persons displaying behaviors that is unbecoming. So I could imagine if that was all. See, the problem is why I have a problem with it, not so much that it can't be done, but because the Bahamian people lack discipline for the most part, and that will be another major challenge on the police apart from what you have already outlined, and I don't think they have the capacity to deal with something of this magnitude because of what it involves. I totally agree with you. You made the case for it, and based on what I've studied, I'm satisfied that you are accurate and it's correct. But to legalize drugs in this country at this time, with the height of disobedience and lawlessness in this country, I can't go with that at this time, but I will continue to listen. And you did a splendid job. I've learned a lot through your introduction, hour and 20 minutes. And allow somebody else to get in and voice their opinion.
Well, I do appreciate your intervention, my friend. In fact, if you say I've put the case, I appreciate that. Thank you very much for your intervention. We have another caller. Yes, hi. Good day, caller. Welcome to the show.
A godly days of this dark universe along with you, Fan.
Brayman, how are you?
I'm holding, thank God.
Good, man, good.
You know, your diplomatic monologue has a lot of synthesis and semantics in it.
Mm-hmm.
Sila, what say you?
I'm listening to you, Brayman. I want your point of view. I know you are a very conservative Bahamian. Talk to me.
You know, in the 1930s, the United States and other countries were making ropes and sail for sailboat out of the marijuana.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. You're right. You're right about that.
You know?
Yep, you're right about that.
So, my point is, we as a country, we should, those that's in authority, get all of the intelligent people together, you know, in a conference, and let us govern our country as we know it should be governed. If not, all we're going to be doing is killing up, especially the black people.
Absolutely, Brayman.
Thank you for your time.
Oh, my, thank you very much, Brayman. Brayman, you hit the nail on the head. Ladies and gentlemen, he's right. If we do not find a way to end the drug war on the street, and notice I said in all those ways in which the so-called war has been launched, all the tools they've been employing, all the dysfunctional things that we've been doing, if we don't do that, our young men will continue to mass murder and kill each other. Welcome to the show. Good day. Hello. Are you there?
Hello.
Yeah, good day. Welcome to the show.
Good day. Mr. Thompson.
Speak to me, my brother.
Okay. Man, I must say this is a very timely show. And this is something I feel like I am sitting inside that seat and stare at you. Everything I wanted, why Wallace wanted it, heard on the radio.
I appreciate that.
So we really have to look at where our crime really start. And see, first, let me say I am vice chairman of the House of Rastafari, so I have a big stake in legalization of marijuana.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But okay. I wouldn't even speak about that right now because we have a bigger problem.
Mm-hmm.
If we don't really see what the root of this problem is, and the same police against the citizenry. And that's all we're doing. We know that crime pays. Most of our crime we have in the country right now is through the introduction of what they call marijuana drugs. And if you were to stop those arrests, imagine who all would be out of a job. We'd have magistrates, we'd have lawyers, we'd have prison officers, we'd have police officers them if they get the crime. So nobody want to deal with crime because they see their job leaving the minute crime is really dealt with. And we need crime to be done. Everybody wants. Yes, we have a drug problem. And marijuana is not a drug. And we need to stop calling it a drug. And if we start really educating people on what that plant is, we'll stop looking at it as a drug. We also have cocaine. We also have other illicit drugs here in this country, too.
Absolutely.
That really causes the problem. Now, like you say, we fighting these guys fighting for corners and everything else. Like that. If we legalize marijuana, that will take a great part out of it. And that's why most of the drug dealers do not want to see it legalized.
Absolutely.
Some of the people fighting hardest against it instead of selling the illegal marijuana, because legal marijuana kill their industry, make it legal. Look, what the guy talk about with police officers, them on the street trying to, there would be no police in something that is illegal. That's the thing. But when you still have a medical side, you still have an illegal side, so you still need the police, and there goes crime pays.
Absolutely.
Nobody really want to deal with the crime.
Listen, you hit it. Go ahead.
That's coming from me, a Rastafarian.
I appreciate the call, my brother. I appreciate the call. In fact, I appreciate your intervention because it tells me that the Bahamian people are listening out there. 323-6232. Thank you for your call. 325-4316, 325-4259. Call in. I like the commentary. The Bahamian people understand this, but guys, y'all gotta punch them telephone buttons and say, listen, man, we can't have no more Jerome Avenue in Chesapeake. There's a reason for this. This could be resolved, and this could be resolved quickly. And there's something I won't say, but I can wait because the callers have been patiently waiting, and we're going to go back to it. Welcome to the show, caller.
Yes, good afternoon, Mr. Johnson.
Mr. Thompson.
Thompson?
Yes, sir.
All right, you know, you sound like Van Johnson. You're a very passionate speaker, you know, and I appreciate that, right?
Appreciate that.
And so, you know, I'd be 57 in August, right? I know everybody hear my voice on the radio, right, Mr. Johnson?
Okay.
But so, you're so right on point with all your social narratives, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's hurtful to me. You know, I heard my first cousin on the radio, has three sons, right?
Mm-hmm.
And my eyes run water. And so, of course, you know, my cousin was a gangster, right?
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it just hurt me to see his last breath and his life. And I know that from those little boys, Mr. Thompson, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I used to frequent the area. As a matter of fact, the commissioner of police, you know, like, I was in the yard a couple of times in Canada, but I don't want to get into my history because a lot of people don't know me. They feel that I'm socially diversified.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm able, I diversify. And so we need some interdiction programs. And people like me, schools, Carlos know me well. You know, mm-hmm. I used to meet you H3 like 30 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
These guys are babies to me. I don't know if you remember the Whit Monday shooting.
No, I don't believe.
Yeah, years ago with the guy. But these guys, it was no interdiction. I watched these guys turn thing there. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like no one was there to interdict and deal with these social inner city programs. But to be honest with you, right, when you start up the whole chronology about the drug era, my mind went back on Eugene Hausenfuss and Lieutenant North, Colonel Oliver North, and the Sandinistas and the CIA mix up with the drugs and the fake war on drugs.
That's right.
You understand? But see, most people are underread, and so we buy into all of these social constructs, right?
Mm-hmm.
And like how you mentioned the fact that, you know, just over-policing and overspending on the police isn't going to work. But
no.
The thing is, it's sad that the guy would be on WhatsApp saying the police getting mixed up in the people business and everybody saying, well, they should do the phone work to see who made the call to say with the guys that was released and all that. But the police force is not exempted from gang affiliation because we all go to school together and we are denying these cultures within these organizations. But the thing is, we all know about the Chris Cullmer. We all know about the role, the CDO role being shot by the place on Village Road years ago. I was arrested with one of those guys a long time ago. But like I say, I'm socially diversified. And I listen, this has nothing to do with Moshe. This is about the shooting from Whit Monday that carried on henceforth. And so it's hurtful to me that we must get strong. Hey, Mr. Thompson, if we don't get serious, like I listen to Lang. And I think some of Lang's best shows was this week. So and Lang failed to mention that the elephants had witnessed their parents being shot by humans. And so I'm saying it's the violence that these guys grew up seeing. Man, I know these guys when they're little babies, basically. And his mother's correct. He was in and out. But I know the other brothers, I was more closer than them.
Well, I don't want to go into too much detail about
But what I'm saying is, it's sad that people would be putting the police in this, right?
Yes, I
but
agree.
But totally. They themselves are responsible for that because of their past. We know about their past. We know about why witnesses were made anonymous.
Mm-hmm.
All right? So we're full of filth and guilt. And we're living with our heads in the sand as far as this gang culture. So there is a difference between, even though drugs may be the cause, there still is a difference between drug war and gang wars. Have a good day.
Thank you very much. I appreciate your call. Listen, I like they come in fast and furious. Please, you know, continue calling. I don't know if I'll be able to get back to doing some things. I got some recommendations, but I want you guys to help us out in terms of trying to deal with some things that we must do. First, let me go to the text messages. You are chasing a red herring. Your points are all over the place. Let's talk about the plight of our youth, parenting, and civic participation to build a better nation. Another person says, sir, your tone and voice is appropriately for the level of mess in this country. Politics is everything, and to hell with the citizens. I cover you in prayers. Well, I thank you very much. Blessings, Mr. Thompson. And they quote 1 Samuel 15 and 13. And Samuel said, as thy sword hath made women childless, so thy mother be childish among women. And they go on. One person says, I talk too fast. Well, excuse me, and I apologize for that. Some blaming the government, and we all know they're being political. I totally agree with that. In fact, if that's what you're going to do on this show, I won't even entertain your commentary, to tell you the truth. Fathers and mothers are in trouble. I seriously doubt law enforcement were not involved in locating these six men. I've heard that before. In fact, my good friend Levon made that point earlier on the show. I'll tell you what, the precision of the strike was impressive. And when I say impressive, I don't mean impressive in terms of taking the lives of those decent young men, even though some of them may be alleged to be young men of the streets. Clearly, they did not kill who they were not supposed to kill, if we want to speculate. And I don't want to speculate, because remember, ladies and gentlemen, the mantle of the presumption of innocence imbues all of them, inside the car and outside the car. So and let me just not go very much further with that. Welcome to the show, caller. Hi.
Hello.
Hi, caller.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Go ahead.
Oh, excellent show. I heard you earlier.
Thank you.
Really impressed because of your past as a judge, eh?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you are really the person we need.
Well, you know, I can tease my cousin again. They didn't think so. I offered my services. I offered to give a different perspective. In fact, they would have heard this, the very same perspective. But I suspect that certain people in this country, let me be mischievous right now, and I don't mean to impugn anyone on that commission. But I suspect that this is all about setting up another industry to make 6 or 7 new Bahamian multimillionaires at the expense of the Bahamian people by giving out maybe 6 or 7 licenses. And I hope that's not the case. I hope that when they decide to even do the mealy-mouth legalization of marijuana for medicinal purposes, that it is not corralled by certain Bahamians, and only certain Bahamians, the way the numbers business was taken over by certain Bahamians. That's not what this is about. Well, I hope not. I get your point.
Okay, but then I would like to expand on something that was said earlier in the show that you were on.
Yes, sir.
I think the host mentioned that the precision of the execution was so advanced, which indicate to me that these guys are hardened criminals. Mm-hmm. And I can tell you personally, the worst beating I ever got was when I failed to take a key of cocaine just to Miami. Mm-hmm. Even though I panicked, I took the worst cut up in my life. Thankfully, you know, that was one who was ripping me was a friend. Mm-hmm. So he eased up a bit. But these are hardened criminals. And you may be familiar with how the leader in the Philippines deal with them, eh?
Duterte.
Are you familiar?
Duterte. That's his name. Yeah, I know.
Sorry?
Yeah, I've studied him. I've studied the so-called Philippine drug war. Yes, I have. Duterte.
Okay, well, I mean, so it sounds like, you know, you invite 100 of them to the police station for consultation, and you find out who are the real hardened ones, and you let them all go. But the ones that don't return, you know, they deal with them.
Well, see,
the
this
police
is, this,
actually deals with them.
But this is my problem.
And I don't know whether we need to be leaning toward this is definitely not, in my opinion, what happened.
Okay.
But I don't think you could legislate dealing with these guys.
That's why I'm saying legalize it. Take it out of the realm of
that ain't gonna help.
Of
you know why? Because there's always something that I can lace with the legal one, and you're gonna want that. Because your need has grown beyond the regular sleepiness with marijuana.
Well, see, I'm gonna...
So I can always put something in that. And what has been legalized is obsolete. This is different from alcohol, where you can have different variety of booze and whatnot. But you can, like in Canada, they did that too. But there's still a drug culture.
Well, there is a drug culture. There's always been a drug culture in all worlds. Human beings have been altering their states since the beginning of time. They say nothing new.
So obviously, we need to get into the hearts of individuals and really, from early, help them understand the reason why their souls migrated to this solar system. Well, you see, Satan has done a really, really, really good job in preventing us from seeing the reason for being here.
I hear you. Thank you.
And I think if we can solve that, instead of having all these various denominations teaching this one, that one, come to my church and you'll find salvation and prosperity, and then the other one teaching that one is wrong, you go right down the road, until we could unify the one religion, which is nature, then we don't have this problem, sir.
I totally hear you, sir. Thank you very much for your call.
Okay, all right.
I appreciate that. Let's go back to the telephone lines. We have another caller. Hi, caller. Welcome to the show.
Good afternoon, Mrs. Payne. How you doing?
By the grace of God, my brother.
Sparky, hear you, old
Sparky.
Boy.
Yeah, man. How you doing? Good to hear your voice.
I heard you in the fire all day from morning to night now.
Don't tell nobody. It's a secret.
Boy, look here. I was trying long. When you said, Ted, you wasn't going to talk to nobody. I said, oh, this man, don't try to run the whole ship by yourself. Don't give nobody a chance to even ask a question.
Yeah.
Nahaja
gave me a 2-hour job, so I had to take my time.
Yeah, but you know, not only that, there's so many things to say. You got the marijuana issue. You got the incident that happened on Jerome Avenue yesterday. Mm-hmm. There's so much things hot in our country right now. If you give me a moment here.
Sure.
I don't mean to detract, but because you are a lawyer, well-spoken, well-knowledge, and everything, I want to ask this particular question in regards to the vaccine thing.
Sure.
If you bear with me.
Sure.
The gentleman who said that we can't stop him from threatening his employers for not taking the vaccine or losing their job. Right?
Sparky, where are you going there? I can answer you real quick, because that's not the subject of the
question.
Real quick. You can't force me to put nothing in my body I don't want in my body. Nothing.
Yeah, no, but what I'm saying is, listen to this. Can the employees say...
No.
No, listen what I'm saying. But can the employees say, sir, okay, that's what the conditions we're working at. Can you make sure that all your customers come in here Show us the vaccine that they took.
I think the better thing to do is to say, okay, you pay for my medical insurance. You ensure that you cover my medical expense if anything go wrong, and I'll take the vaccine. Or I say, no, sir, I'm not going to do it. I leave in your job. And once I leave my job, go to the Labor Department, go find a lawyer, and then sue the company for constructive dismissal. But I ain't going no further with that, Sparky. Would talk to me about our topic.
Well, you know what? You know, our topic is I have nothing against legalizing marijuana because I personally know that people have different experiences. As you know, Sparky grew up in the Valley.
Absolutely.
After around 17, 18, I was exposed to marijuana when some of my cousins and friends went off to school. And when they came back, they came back and introduced me into it.
Mm-hmm.
And I walked up and down. Mrs. Thompson, I have worked in international banking. I've worked with Matelco Communications.
Mm-hmm.
I have managed fishing lodges on Out Island. I have worked all around this place. I've never been to court in my life for marijuana. I've never had no problem in smoking of marijuana and so forth. People have different experiences and so forth. I believe the marijuana business is just a big business. They're keeping it illegal because that's where the money is.
Mm-hmm.
If they make it legal now, I will be able to grow in my backyard, and nobody will be able to tell me that I can smoke it or not.
Absolutely.
Just like alcohol.
Yeah.
And cigarettes.
Yes.
They keep it illegal because it's a business.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I get you. Sparky, you know, I've heard that before, and let me say that I think there's also another reason, too. I believe that we have some relationships with the Americans. I believe that our politicians are terrified to make a big decision. Carl Bethel has made it very clear. Not until the Americans legalize at the federal level is the Bahamas going to move, which to my mind is a capitulation to poor
public
policy.
Well, why do we have to wait till they legalize it?
You must ask
to legalize it.
You have to ask
Mr.
Bethel.
And let me ask a question. My father told me that back when he started me smoking marijuana on the Mount Royal block,
mm-hmm.
he says, son, let me tell you something. The only reason I tell you to stop fooling with it because it's illegal.
Mm-hmm.
You're messing up your family name. You're messing up your future, this, that.
Yeah.
Illegal.
Yeah.
He said because in the 1920s and everything, when he was growing up, all of that was legal. People just smoked that just like they smoke a cigarette.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody's doing nothing.
It only became illegal.
That was the big problem.
You're right. In fact, they used to make the rope that they used to tie up boats in the Bahamas out of sisal. That's Indian hemp.
But
you know,
we built a brewery. And now saw and more alcohol coming uptown for that brewery every Friday.
Absolutely.
To full of these bars. So everybody from Montague to Fish Fry, all the hotels, could get drunk all weekend.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the worst drugs in the world.
Absolutely. The worst drug.
But it's legal.
Yes, it is.
And they only trying to give certain families the license
mm-hmm.
to grow these things in certain areas of the Bahamas, and the same old families to be involved with these businesses again. You watch it happen.
Well, I appreciate listening.
Have a good day.
Listen, Sparky, I appreciate always hearing from you. Thank you very much. That's Sparky, my good friend, my Valley boy brother, because I did grow up in the Valley, a proud Valley boy, Clifton Street. Don't hide that. And that's where I heard the story about Mr. Roll, you know, the man who killed 6 or 7 people, and then the comparisons being made to mass murder. Listen, yesterday was the first time we suffered mass murder in the Bahamas. Intentional mass murder. Mr. Roll was a seriously disturbed man who was very distraught because he had been rejected by a lady. He went and he killed some people, and he killed himself and members of his family. Mr. Roll was not a mass. He was seriously disturbed. He was mentally ill. What happened yesterday was Chicago came to the Bahamas. Pregnant pause. Let's go back to the telephone lines. Hi, caller. Welcome to the show.
Hey, Mr. Thompson. How are you doing?
Right here. How are you doing?
Yeah, man, I'm doing well. It's good to hear your voice.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Yeah, but you know what would be powerful
mm-hmm.
if they start putting drones in the air, plane with controls by, voting and all that. They need to start putting drones in the air.
Why do you want the state watching what you do in the privacy of your home over your roof? Suppose you want to relax with your wife in the backyard and she's swimming nude. Why do you want drones flying over your house?
Okay, this is what I want you to do for me. I want you, when any of you have time, explain it.
Mm-hmm.
But I just was here, I heard you spoke about it.
I will do that right now. Thank you
okay,
very much.
I
appreciate
you.
That. Listen, that's a very good question. Because, you know, I made the point earlier that one of the reasons why we have to be so mindful of the damage that the drug war has done to us is that there have been pieces of legislation which have vastly intruded upon our private space. Vastly intruded upon
our
private space.
If you'd like to make a call, please.
vastly intruded upon our private space. So much so that, for example, our telephone calls are being monitored. Some say by the local police. That's an allegation. That's all I can say, Mr. Commissioner. Some say that our telephone calls are being monitored by the Americans in association with the relationship they have with the drug enforcement apparatus in the Bahamas, or by virtue of the op-bat relationship. If that is true, then our privacy has been impacted by this frightful, errant war on drugs, or war to so-called interdict drugs and to police this so-called narco economy. We have to be real. There are some very serious drawbacks which have occurred as a result of the so-called desire to fight this particular war, which is not a war in the first place. It's not a war in the first place. It is all about our society coming to terms with the fact that we have to do things differently. And this is nothing new coming from Fain Thompson. Check it out. Countries around the world have already gone in this direction. Just the other day, Mexico did something which was a powerful. And I'm not going to tell you what Mexico did. You guys go and check it out. Portugal did something powerful in 2001. The American government did something powerful in the 1930s. Uruguay did something powerful in 2005 or 2007. I want you guys to pick up your books. You don't even got to pick up a book. Click it. Go click. YouTube. You'll find all the information. Yeah, do you have any more? Well, again, let me tell you what our numbers are. 323-6232. 325-4316. 325-4259. Our text line is 422-4796. Feel free to call in and share with us a point of view. Now, I saved this particular part of the show. We only have about 20 minutes left. I saved this particular part of the show for this purpose. And if you have some calls coming through, we'll take the calls as they come, Mr. Producer. We'll take the calls as they come. The men and women who now comprise the soldiers of this business are businessmen. I want to bring to this particular conversation some decency. That's a caller. Look, caller, listen, let me finish this one thought. When you think about the men who walk around with guns and shoot down each other, they are men in suits, but they're suits, not in suits. They're not men in suits, but they are businessmen. Those who go around killing each other are the security officers who stand at the door to cover boss business. The boss man is the CEO. The product of choice is cocaine, marijuana, whatever drug he has been moving. His tools of his business would be a Glock 9 or an AK-47. If you step out of line, there are consequences. I'm going to stop there. That particular regime of running a business is the exact same regime that we employ in mainstream lawful businesses. I say that to say this, that if we resolve the problem of this errant drug war, we must accept that these men with guns have to be brought into the mainstream. Not as it were, to make them respectable citizens. We're talking about future business people. They have to be brought into the mainstream to take away and undercut the violence of the business. That's inevitable. It's happening all over America as we speak. It happened in Canada. It's happening even in Jamaica. It's happening in parts of other parts of the Caribbean. It happens in other parts of the world a long time ago. We have to accept that the unpoliceable, it is not ever going to be policeable. So when you see a police officer, you shake his hand and you say, "Officer, I feel for you. I understand." When you see the commissioner, tell the commissioner, "I feel for you, sir. I understand. You must be seen to be doing something about something you have no control over." The happenstance of our homicide figures dipping one year and going up the next is all about the cyclical nature of this particular narco economy. If you don't understand what the word narco economy means, please check it out. N-A-R-C-O, economy. N-A-R-C-O, economy. That is what we've been living in for the past 30 years. And with bad policy to police this particular situation, we have gone from bad to worse. We are now Chicago style, killing each other. That can't make no sense. Let's go back to the telephone lines. We have another caller coming. Hi, caller. Welcome to the show.
Good afternoon. How are you doing?
My brother, how are you?
All right. I ain't here for me a long time, man.
Don't tell nobody, man. I hear your voice in ages, too. That's true.
I know that. Mr. Thompson, your endeavor is very good.
Thank you.
You know, when Mr. Minnis mentioned in January that he's going to have medicinal marijuana legalized, right?
Mm-hmm.
And there was a thing by some of the top of my QCs in this town saying that, well, medicinal marijuana is always legal. All you have to do is go to a doctor and get your prescription.
That's true.
Is that true?
That is correct.
Okay, so why is it that
every drug that we employ and use for medical purposes right now in the country is done so on under a medical under the provisions of the so-called Health Act, and doctors have to be lawfully authorized to dispense. Absolutely correct. Absolutely correct. Yes, sir.
Okay, so that means that one would only have to go to that doctor to get a prescription from that doctor to use medicinal marijuana in this country.
I have no idea how they propose to do it. I know I remember the story of a former member of
Parliament. No, but you're saying you don't know how to do it. But it was never illegal for medicinal marijuana.
I'm not going to say it wasn't illegal, because unless you get a special approval under a certain schedule of the act, then it is illegal. You have to fall within a certain schedule and be permitted to get it.
Marijuana is Schedule 2, right?
It is scheduled, yes, sir.
Yeah, but Schedule 2 drugs have no medicinal value, but marijuana does have a medicinal value.
I take your point.
It's been on a fraudulent list.
I get you.
You also said that if you go to your doctor and he recommends you smoking marijuana for like glaucoma, asthma, or any kind of nerve damage or pain or whatever.
That's correct.
As a citizen, you should have a right to have a prescription to get this marijuana, to get your medicinal marijuana.
I always err on the side of the science. If the science says so, then I see nothing wrong with it. Once you do it in a lawful way. Remember now, I'm not suggesting that you break the law. Some people are saying that
No.
Okay.
You're armed with a letter from your doctor. I'm asking you. Because
yes,
if you go to the doctor to get a prescription, the doctor would have to write on the letter would deviate your condition.
I think.
And if you recommend that, that would be able to stand even before the court.
Yes. Because you have not violated any particular norm, and the doctor's authorized to do what he's doing. Yes.
So, in essence, as long as you hold that letter, would you be able to like you say, if you go before law enforcement or the court, I beg your pardon?
Let me answer the question this way. You would not have to go before the court, because the first time, the moment the police officer sees that you have that authorization, he won't even charge you.
Okay.
Yeah.
So once you have a letter from your doctor, that's it.
I don't know how it's done, but I take your point, and I'm agreeing with you. Once you have that authorization, and you can prove that, then you're covered. All right?
Okay.
All right.
Yes, sir.
I appreciate
your
call.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, man.
Okay.
323-323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259, 422-4796 if you want to share a comment with us on the show today. Now, it's going to be interesting to see how this particular unfolds. And what I want you to do, this is a point in time where I wanted to bring this home. I want to bring this home. The tools of the trade are the go-fast boats, the drug houses, the guns, the competition in the small spaces, the darkness of the business. Their security officers are somewhere between 18 to 30 years of age. They are prepared to kill to protect market share. Notice what I'm saying, ladies and gentlemen. Market share, product, job, and maintain discipline in the business. And when the boss says, you have to kill, they comply without a flinch to prove their loyalty and their value. The debasement of the drug war is there for all to see. The business is illicit, and for that reason, it has an extremely high value. It offers no ability to settle disputes, to lawfully and or otherwise resolve issues, and there are too many incentives for negative behavior by many disadvantaged young men. Because no matter what we may talk about, you must understand that this industry attracts men who need to take care of their families. That is the nature of the world in which we live. And this presentation today, I hope, has focused on the fact that we blinked in that report from the Commission on Marijuana. We blinked. And when I say we, I do not mean Reverend Simeon Hall blinked. I do not mean my good family, Quinn McCartney, blinked. I believe that as a collective, we blinked. We have an opportunity to end the violence associated with an errant drug war. We have an opportunity to go in the direction in which many other countries have gone. We have an opportunity to end the violence of the streets. We have an opportunity to ensure that Fox Hill and Jerome Avenue never happen again. We have been blinking. There's only one way to correct that. Between now and the next general election, the Prime Minister and his men, Mr. Davis and his men, Ms. Komalafe, all them other fellows who want to be Prime Minister, there must be a crescendo rising from below to do the job of rescuing our young people from themselves. There's only one way to do this. We can't do it halfway by legalization of medicinal marijuana without more. There's a huge side to this business, the demand side, which requires I should say the supply side, the supply, you know, the demand side, which requires that we take the prohibition against use away from our laws. We must bring the peace dividend that we will enjoy by ensuring that police officers will no longer be bothered by these silly calls to arrest young men and women on the streets for simple, nonsensical charges. That peace dividend can be used by deploying our public service assets in a much more productive way, by investing in the health initiatives which are needed to rescue these people from their own problems. Understand that drug use is invariably normally the case when persons have issues that they have to deal with. And some people are functional drug users. So not everybody is crazy, or not everybody has serious problems. This is a lucrative business. See it as that, Mr. Policymaker. This is a lucrative business. Do not give it to 6 Bahamian families. Do not do that. But go further than the recommendation given to you by the commission to step into recreational drug use and legalizing it to the extent and to the value that you can do it. And I accept that things don't happen overnight, but it is a manifest waste of time to just simply talk about legalizing marijuana for the purposes of medicinal use. That could be done right now with a telephone call and with a cabinet paper. There's no magic in that. That could be done very easily. The 4 ministers of national security for the last 3 or 4 renditions of governments in this country all agree. Mr. Tommy Turnquest, Madam Cynthia Mother Pratt, Mr. Bernard Nottage, Mr. Dames, they've all opined the obvious, that the culture in which we live is racked with violence born of a drug trade, born of the narco economy. This is the time. Jerome Avenue, Chesapeake Avenue is the time to look again at whether or not we have gone far enough to bring peace to our streets. My good friend Carlos Reed's favorite words. I'm not going to sit here and pretend about the moral turpitude in which is involved and whether or not we legalize marijuana or simply use it for medicinal purposes. I believe that there is an imperative, a legal imperative, to bring peace to our streets, to employ the rule of law as ought to be employed to move in this direction. It is not anti-rule of law. It is pro-rule of law. The police should not be asked to police the unpoliceable. They should not be put in the line of fire to quell the line of fire. Can you imagine if police officers had been caught up in that event yesterday? That would have been a massive shootout. And chances are, they would have been outgunned. Because the firepower, I understand, them fellas had were AK-47s. They spray bullets. 30 rounds a second. They sprayed them. They would have been outgunned and that's it. That's not what we want to do. And let's stop militarizing our police force to pretend as if something is being done. And stop rolling around in tanks and putting guns at our police officers' feet to pretend as if they're doing something with all this firepower that they're carrying around. It doesn't achieve anything except show. And for some reason, perhaps intimidation by some errant people. This is what we have to do. This is what we have to do. End this drug war. End this drug war. Don't end it because Fain Thompson says so. Don't end it because I may not believe in your God the way you believe. End it because it's a social imperative for the survival of this little nation and our democracy. We have become Chicago as of last night. Chicago. And in no way, no public, no policy maker will be able to stop it. No way. Because if another hit is required, it will take place. You see, what happened last year when you enjoyed, Mr. Prime Minister, that lull in the so-called frequency of homicides was because we were locked down. We were locked down. Everybody was scared of disease. Bahamians are now tipping outside again. The economies, these private industries are popping up again. The illicit businesses have to put themselves back in order again. Now, I'm suggesting that if that is what happened over the last 24 hours, and that goes back to some bad blood that these groups or these gangs have, there are ways of solving this. Empower these young men. Bring these illicit businessmen into the mainstream. Tax, supervise, and regulate that business. Welcome, caller, to the show. Hi, caller. Caller, you there? Are you there, caller? Anyhow, are you there, caller? One more time.
Yes, sir. I'm saying, how you doing, Sheldon Johnson?
Speak to me, Sheldon.
Yeah. Just let me say that medicinal marijuana is legal in the Bahamas. You just need a prescription and an advance notice for whoever it is to
imported into the country.
Absolutely.
Just a letter from the Ministry of Health. Mm-hmm. So when they begin to have this conversation concerning the legalization of medical medicinal marijuana, it's mm-hmm. already legal on the books. So that's why I don't understand what this discussion is.
I think Mr. Fenton Nemo all but shared that with us, didn't he?
Yes, he did, but yes, so did the minister, former Minister of Health,
yes.
as well as other QCs.
Yes, yes.
And so this is why I always thought this exercise was futile. I think the conversation needs to go into the cultivation and decriminalization of marijuana. But mm-hmm. we always seem to have conversation out of context, because I basically believe that we don't want to have a proper conversation because it allows the mm-hmm. misinformation and misdirection of those that who don't know. But as far as marijuana, I do believe that just how we just passed the intellectual capital bill, I do believe that the all marijuana swans known and unknown mm-hmm. should be deposited into a sovereign wealth fund to be mm-hmm. licensed mm-hmm. for any and anybody.
Well, describe the industry. Describe the industry you would establish, a regulated recreational use of marijuana industry. Describe it. Set it up real quick for us. We only got a few minutes.
I would go with considering our size, I would go with a licensing aspect to it, be in possession of marijuana, mm-hmm. and then I would look at the combination of a health rehabilitative program for mm-hmm. those under a particular age, as opposed to the prison system.
Mm-hmm.
But by virtue of decriminalization, it requires a little bit more discussion than we have.
Absolutely.
But I do believe that when you talk about the handing it over to a small group, if it's owned by the sovereign wealth fund, the intellectual capital of any known and any future strains that can be cultivated, because when you begin to plant in Andres and Abaco and Grand Bahama, mm-hmm. each one of them produce different strains.
Mm-hmm.
So if you will own the intellectual capital to them, just like the big farm and the rest of them do, which will then, as we license it, will enumerate
you're talking about
the sovereign wealth fund that is controlled by a separate company, not government, sovereign development management company.
Okay, but listen, Cialan. Yeah, but Cialan, it is a conversation we need to have. And unfortunately, you know, maybe we need to invite the commission to resume its deliberations. But anyway, I'll leave it like that.
Yeah,
Thank you very much.
They won't, because I went to their meetings, and what they do is when you question them and you want to go in the right direction,
mm-hmm.
they shut it down. They'll talk for 2 hours until you got 3 minutes.
Yeah.
And so you basically go that you must be came here with a predetermination, because how do you engage the public? And you say you got 3 minutes at the mic to explain what, to ask what question.
Okay.
So when you have a consultative environment, you engage people trying to actually
and
come
do
to
the right way.
A solution.
Thank you very much, Cialan. Cialan called. One more caller. We have one more caller. Let's get that one caller in. Hi, caller. Real quick. Oh, no, that's it. That's it. Okay, good. Mr. Producer, thank you very much. You've been most kind and you've assisted me greatly in this space. My sister, Nahaja. Thank you for the opportunity to sit in for you, and I hope I've made you proud. I remember Nahaja, and Nahaja is my little sister. But beyond that, gifted. She's a necessary voice in a changing Bahamas, and fearless as they may come. So I appreciate the opportunity to just sit here and to share with the Bahamian people. I felt a need to do this, if only because. But I think this must be in the public domain. When they sit down and they have the little private conversations now and deciding whether or not they should carve this new industry out to just a certain number of families, even if they go the direction of recreational use, I want them to think long and hard. And I also want them to remember that there are two sides to the business. There's a demand side and the supply side. Both sides are not solved by simply decriminalizing. You have to legalize. You have to legalize. Legalization brings peace to the streets. Decriminalization only helps them to avoid walking around with records for the rest of their lives. Let's stop this timid nonsense of pretending that the problem doesn't exist. Jerome Avenue and Chesapeake was the watershed moment. Jerome Avenue and Chesapeake Avenue was the watershed moment. Chicago has come to the streets of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. I want you guys to be safe out there. Be safe over the weekend. God bless and keep safe. The Commonwealth of the Bahamas.